From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. This is the JAMA Author Interview Podcast. I'm Dr. Kirsten Bibbins-Domingo, Editor-in-Chief of JAMA and the JAMA Network. I'm speaking today with Dr. Jack Resneck, who is professor and chair of the Department of Dermatology at the University of California, San Francisco. He's also the former president of the American Medical Association. But relevant for today's discussion is that Dr. Resneck chaired the workgroup of the World Medical Association. This workgroup led the revision to the Declaration of Helsinki that JAMA is publishing today. The Declaration of Helsinki outlines the ethical principles for medical research involving humans. It was first adopted in 1964 by the World Medical Association and has been revised several times. JAMA is publishing this 2024 revision to the Declaration of Helsinki. Dr. Resneck, thanks for joining me here today. I hope we can be on a first-name basis.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Jack, the Declaration of Helsinki is well known to people in this field, but might not be known to everyone. I just gave a brief introduction. Tell our listeners, why is this declaration so important?
Well, Kirsten, as you said, this was a declaration that was adopted in 1964. It's actually 60 years ago this month, and really grew out of the wake of horrible ethical failures of physicians in the Nazi era during World War II and the Nuremberg trials that followed. And you think about the thalidomide disaster several years later. And the declaration really was an effort to set the stage and create this set of baseline bedrock ethical principles for physicians and others to follow when conducting research on human participants, particularly in medical research.
So it's important, and it's been around now for multiple decades. Why is the revision important, or what's new in this revision that we should know about?
Well, some have argued that ethical principles should really be set in stone and shouldn't change as time goes on. If they're truly ethical principles, right, aren't they just solid and there forever? But the reality is, and when you think about, again, the history of this document, it grew out of harms that we actually saw in respect to individual participants in medical research. And as the world changes, we discover new risks and new harms. This particular revision, for example, addresses some of the risks to patient confidentiality in a world of AI and machine learning and big data collection and some of the harms we've seen there. So we try not to change it too often. The World Medical Association, on average, does this about once a decade. But there are just new things that need to be addressed. And we think this really maintains the document's gravitas and relevance in a changing world.
Right. So you've also authored a viewpoint for us that really highlights some aspects of both the process and what readers should look for in the revisions. And you've just talked about one, AI, as being an area that we want to protect individuals who are involved in research. But give us an idea of some other things. So I know some of the revision is just to language, but important language. So tell us a little bit about that.
So the Declaration of Helsinki, and if it's okay, I'm going to call it the DOH for our discussion, is quite different than some of the other documents that are out there talking about human participant research. So the DOH keeps with very high-level principles. There are just 37 of them. It's only a few pages long. You can read it in a few minutes. It now lives in this ecosystem of a lot of other rules out there issued by regulatory bodies or different countries in their laws or the WHO or UNESCO and other groups. So these are not granular procedural rules. They really are high-level principles. And so you mentioned one around data use. So this is paragraph 32, which has been rewritten. And paragraph 32 really used to be about biobanking. So you think years ago, the issue was, well, we might store samples from a patient, for example, who enrolls in a clinical trial, and maybe we want to do subsequent research on that blood or that tissue that has been sampled. So you'd want to make sure to have consent to do that. Well, now in a world of big data, you can imagine just all the breadth of things that get collected around patients. Even de-identified data, we've now seen how that can sometimes be re-identified. We've even seen examples where data have been commercially inappropriately used afterwards. So the declaration now basically says, hey, if you're going going to collect data and you're going to plan to store it for multiple uses downstream, you need to get consent up front. And if you decide to go and do that later, you actually need to either go back to patients and get consent, or if that's impractical, you need to go to a research ethics committee to explain why you need to do that. So we think that was one important addition.
Thanks for setting it up. That's really helpful to know the genesis of that particular section and how it makes sense that you're updating now to a time when it seems we're in a position to always be potentially giving our data over for research and sort of stating where the ethical guidelines are here. Other examples that you would point to in the revision?
So there's a lot of change this go round in just the general tone. And I think words are really important. So the way we talk about the folks who are engaged in research and in the enterprise, the way we talk about the communities where research is done. So let me just take a simple example. The old version referred to patients and healthy volunteers who were participating in research as subjects. And the word subjects itself, right, has some connotations about who's in charge. And so we changed the word subjects to participants throughout the document. And this is really out of respect for the rights and the agency and the importance of those participants and really thinking of them as partners and co-creators in the research enterprise. There's also language about meaningful engagement now being required with potential participants in communities so that researchers don't just show up somewhere in a community and start enrolling people in a trial without talking to that community about what their needs are and what their goals are for their health and their group's health. Another change around language, the document used to be addressed to physicians, though the World Medical Association is basically a federation of national medical associations. It is part of the profession and represents millions of physicians around the globe. And I think in the past, there was a hesitance to say, hey, can we really create a declaration that speaks to people outside of our profession? But there's a recognition now that, hey, if we believe so much in the rights and respect for participants in research, and that that is so core to our beliefs and our ethics and our morals as a profession, that of course we would want to step up and say these ethical principles are vital to the protection, no matter who's on the research team or who happens to be doing that research. So those are a couple of the language changes.
As you say, words matter, and choosing words and the context around the words that really embody the principles ends up being as important. So that's really great. What was the process for revising this? Is just you and a few people sitting in a room just making this up? Or it sounds like you've been working on this for a while. So tell us a little bit about the process.
This has become a big part of my life and a really interesting part of my life for the last few years. This has actually been a 30-month long process. So the World Medical Association wanted to ensure that this was deeply inclusive. The first thing that they did was to create a work group, and this was a work group from within the World Medical Association that involved representation from 19 different countries, also had a number of bioethics advisors on the work group. You mentioned that I, alongside the American Medical Association, took a leadership role, but really as conveners in this process. And then to make sure we had broad input, we held 8 regional and topical meetings, really on continents around the globe. We invited regional experts and stakeholders to each of those meetings, and actually local countries in those areas got to pick topics that interested them and speakers based on controversies that had arisen around the declaration in recent years. So those meetings were fascinating. You'd have researchers sitting down with patients and bioethicists and regulatory body and government officials, members of actual research ethics committees, educators, national medical society leaders, folks from pharma and industry. So we really wanted both globally and geographically diversity from those standpoints and also from the different stakeholders who were sitting around that table. We also held not one, but 2 public comment periods. So it was an iterative process where we would put out proposals, release them out on the internet for everybody to see. And those public comment periods generated really enthusiastic and engaged feedback from around the world from a number of stakeholders. So our work group and a smaller drafting group would get together and go over every single one of those and continue to make those iterative changes, which led to the full changes in the draft that you see in this issue of JAMA.
Anything surprise you in this process? Were there things that were harder than you expected or things that you're particularly proud of when you think about the whole process?
It turns out bioethics is hard. And it's interesting because it's hard and because we often have ethical principles that bump into each other and are in conflict. And I think if it were straightforward, right, we wouldn't need to do all this work and all of this convening. I'm not a bioethicist by training. I really functioned as a convener of this group and learned a ton throughout this process. But I think one of the surprises was just the degree of stakeholder and regional variation on some issues. There are some that are not new. They've been historically controversial. The use of placebo and maybe different feelings in some Latin American countries than in other parts of the world about when that's appropriate and not appropriate based on lived experience and history of various trials that we've seen. I was really pleasantly surprised just by the degree of engagement from all over the world. People were really interested in this. When they recognized that it was an inclusive process, they showed up. People came to these regional and topical meetings. There was a real focus this year, we didn't get a chance to talk about it before, on thinking about what it means to be a vulnerable population. The Declaration historically, again, out of the history of some of the wrongs and abuses in the name of research in the past, took some strong stands on protecting vulnerable populations, and that was really important and justified. But I think we've come to recognize that starting with that default of exclusion of vulnerable populations and thinking about how dynamic and how much vulnerability can change even day to day for different populations, you can become vulnerable just by being in a trial and showing up at a center where a trial is happening. It can be temporary, it can be permanent, it can be more or less severe. So thinking about changing the language in this version of the Declaration to really focus on how can we responsibly be inclusive to populations experiencing vulnerability and still offer protections, but actually add appropriate supports to help those populations participate. Because that preference for beginning with exclusion actually has worsened disparities and worsened what's happened to those populations and their vulnerability in some ways. You think about the incredible dearth of data that I know JAMA and the publishing community and the research community have been thinking a lot about lately for women, for children around various pharmaceutical products and other things. So it's been a big focus of this revision as well. And I was really interested to see how much attention that got.
Yeah, that's such a great one. I know I've been in a number of settings talking about the FDA has recently come out with plans to try to increase diversity in trials. And there are other initiatives to try to improve. You talked about women and children, people at the extremes of age, older adults, young children, pregnant people. All of these are examples. But moving from that exclusion, which has a little paternalistic piece on it and everything else, to thinking about how we can include in a responsible way, I think was one of those areas that I was really pleased to see this group really grapple with.
We think this is a real responsibility of researchers and the entire ecosystem around research. And it sort of touches on another piece. In paragraph 6 of the Declaration, we also have added new language around distributive and global justice. And we basically call on the research community to really carefully consider how the benefits and the risks and the burdens of research are distributed. So a lot of times researchers have a choice about where to do a trial or what population to enroll in a trial. And so I don't think the research community can all by itself fix every inequity in health on the planet. But research plays an enormous role and can cement those inequities or can, on the other hand, help us make huge strides, whether it's in capacity building in different communities to be able to continue to do research, whether it's in thinking about how we distribute those risks of undergoing research, what happens to a community when we do research there. Those are really important considerations. And so with the new DOH, researchers are going to be called upon as our sponsors to really talk to ethics committees as they're engaging with those communities about why they've made the choices they've made about where to do their projects.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, congratulations to you and the many, many, many people involved in this. 30 months is really a long time to engage in a truly collaborative process for a revision to a very important document that guides how we do research in a responsible way. And it's certainly important we think about it from the perspective as a publisher of that research, but really pleased to see the revision and congratulations on the process. And thank you for joining me to talk about it. it. I'd urge all of our listeners from around the world, you can find the Declaration of Helsinki that is free and accessible to read on our website. You can read viewpoints from Dr. Resneck talking about the process, as well as others in this field commenting on the importance of this document and some of the specifics that Dr. Resneck also mentioned. And we look forward to more of you engaging in the conversations on this topic. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.